Good morning, everyone. Welcome to my home studio. Today, once again, we worship the risen Lord at homes rather than in our church buildings. But His presence is everywhere to be with us. Let us worship the risen Christ with a prayer. We are the people of God. Risen Christ, as we gather today, may we see you and hear you. May we feel you and touch you. And may we know your presence with us today. Amen. The first hymn, God sent his son, they called him Jesus. You may join in the hymn on YouTube.
Come to the first reading
taken from Psalm 16, which is sung by Christine Champion.
Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord, apart from you I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines are falling for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me.
Now we come to the second reading, taken from John's Gospel 20:19-31. This time, a dramatized reading by L.U.M.O.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now, Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you."
Oh.
Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name.
I'll tell you a touching story. Geneva Wood, who is a 90 years old woman in Washington State, she told her story to CBN News. On the 4th March, she fell and fractured her hip. Almost at the same time, a resident died from the COVID-19 in a nursing home. She was taken to the medical center, and there she had a test for the coronavirus. The test was positive. And her family thought it was God's time for her to go. Her condition had worsened. A doctor read some of her favorite passages from the Bible. And one night, she could sense God's presence with her. "His hands were on my body," she said. "I could feel his presence. I knew he was with me." She defeated coronavirus later on, and she was allowed to go home. And she said, "This is a gift from God. His work is not done yet with me." Geneva has become a witness of the resurrection these days. Bless her. Now we come to the John's Gospel. Could you picture the scene described in John's Gospel? On the first Easter morning, Mary Magdalene saw the stone had been removed. She saw two angels at the tomb, and she saw Jesus standing there. Peter and John saw the burial clothes of Jesus, so they saw and believed. When Jesus appeared in the room, Thomas wasn't there. When Jesus said, "Peace be with you," poor Thomas, he wasn't there. Thomas was locked in the terrible memory of Jesus' crucifixion. Moreover, the excitement of other disciples made him more miserable. Hence, Thomas said, "Unless I see him, I will not believe him." So we say, don't be like doubting Thomas, believe. And John's Gospel says, 8 days later, the disciples stayed together in the room, and this time Thomas was there. My peculiar question is here, why did Jesus meet Thomas after 8 days of his resurrection? Not like other disciples. Did he know that Thomas was confined in a dungeon of doubt for 8 days? For Thomas, the last 8 days were like an eternity in his life. You see, sometimes Jesus delays his journey on purpose for a particular reason. Could you remember, he delayed his trip when his friend Lazarus died. These days, we feel that we are locked in a dark dungeon, isolated like disciples and Thomas. Why God is delaying his visit to this world, you may say. Or are we passing through the final judgment in this world today? Nevertheless, God knows what he is performing in his times. Jesus finally comes to see Thomas and says, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Put your hand into the wound in my side. Don't doubt, but believe," he said. Jesus offers Thomas what exactly he had wanted. The purpose of Jesus' delay was for Thomas. Jesus waited for the right time to give him a private lesson. Jesus seems to say here, "Thomas, did you know that there were so many things you couldn't make it by your own knowledge or your expertise?" The purpose of Thomas' lockdown is right here, to learn this lesson. Don't you think the Thomas lockdown experience represents the mind of this unbelieving world? In this festive season, we are confined by the dreadful COVID-19. People are dying day by day. Many people may shout, "Why God is permitting such a terrible virus to this world?" And others may say, "You Christians, don't just tell us about your God, but show us what your God can do in this crisis." The risen Lord seems to be nailed on the cross once again these days. And the world joins the doubting Thomas group. A German theologian, Jürgen Moltmann, claimed in his book, The Theology of Hope, "God himself suffers together with Christ in our human despair, and he places the suffering with hope." When Jesus was crucified on the cross, his Father was there suffering together with his Son. Somehow, his Father God was crucified on the cross. In this regard, I may recall what N.T. Wright said, "When the world is in pain, God himself is groaning from within the heart of the world." Or I may recall what Charles Spurgeon said, "I did grow much in grace when I was in bed with the pain." Chuck Swindoll says, "When you suffer and lose, you are right in the center of God's will." How about John Wesley then? He said, "Even in the greatest afflictions, you ought to testify to God who loves us." And the Apostle Paul defines our suffering in Romans chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. "Suffering creates endurance. Endurance creates character. And character creates confidence. This is the mystery of suffering, or reason of suffering in our world today. At present, the whole world is struggling how to defeat the coronavirus. For me, God seems to challenge this world. Do you need me now? I feel God is delivering a great lesson to this world, particularly to this postmodern world where so many people disown God's grace and rely on modern advances. You see, in Noah's time, God taught his people with a grave lesson. And God taught his people again with another big lesson by smashing the Tower of Babel. Possibly, God is inviting us to a school of Thomas to reconsider the pride of our knowledge, our scientific advance, our pleasure and our social life, and particularly our attitude to nature and nature's environment. You may find a key lesson for this world today in Proverbs chapter 1, 7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Another key lesson I find in Proverbs 16, 18. Pride leads to destruction. A proud attitude brings ruin. Therefore I say, perhaps God seems to say to the world today, people of the world, go back to basic now. If this world is willing to receive the joy of resurrection once again, the world must be on its knees by confessing before God. As we heard from Psalm 16, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. For you will not leave me among the dead. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Francis Bacon says, if a man begins in certainties, he shall end in doubts. If he begins with doubts, he shall end in certainties. And I believe one day God will come to this world saying, put your finger here and see my hands and my wound. I suffered too when you cried seeing your loved ones die. Therefore, let us be real and be humble before God and don't pretend that we can comprehend everything or we can achieve everything in this world. Let us be humble to God. To the best of my belief, God is giving a private lesson to this world today. And we shall see the meaning of this trial at God's appointed time. And in the meantime, I pray, teach us, Lord, we shall listen to you and have mercy upon us. Amen. Now we come to the prayers of intercession. You may see on the screen. Now shall we say the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now this is the sending out prayer. Let us pray. Today once again, we remember that you have turned the history around. You have turned the death into life. You have turned the despair into hope. You replaced our fear with peace. Replace our sadness with joy today. Replace our despair with hope. Thank you, Father, that you raised Jesus from the dead for us. Hallelujah. Amen. Now we go into the world by listening to a resurrection song. See what a morning, gloriously bright, and bless you all. Thank you.
Spirit who clothes faith with certainty.